So this is a great topic, Devlina, and let's get started. People will keep coming in. So when I saw this topic, right, Devlina, I was thinking, is this an alternate, strategy to presenting, thoughts and ideas in a corporate setting, right, where typically, one of the problems with corporates is that there's too much confidence and there's too much, belief in what you are bringing to the table, right? And is this one of the ways to kind of change that narrative and make it a little more like investigative in the sense of evidence and insights and plot and subplots and so on and so forth when you're trying to sell an idea or a story or a product to a customer or within the organization? Is that the idea? I'm just trying to guess here what the topic really means.
That's one of the ideas, Anurag. And I think, where I was coming from is, I love investigative writing. So as you probably know, I write crime fiction, which is as investigative as it gets. So I've written two and I'm writing more historical crime fiction. And I also write investigative, data-driven investigative stories for ET Prime. So, that's again where, we have to really look at what makes the story.
Sorry, is it just me that I can't hear her?
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, now I can hear. Yeah.
Okay. Sorry, I'll just quickly repeat. So I'm saying that, having written crime fiction and writing data-driven stories for ET Prime, I've kind of explored this investigative writing genre quite a lot, right? And so there are a few things which work when you're trying to write in this particular genre, whether you're writing fiction or writing non-fiction. But there are also a few things which, exactly like you mentioned, Anurag, which can be borrowed and learned from how corporates are talking about their story. And I think that I wanted to cover both so that, we kind of start from what works for investigative storytelling. And we also see, what could work when corporates, what scenarios could this be a useful exercise for corporates to think of or to use?
The only point I would like to add is, that I've been working in corporate life for about 22 years now, right?
Yes,
The
yes.
one thing that I've seen in more recent time is this language around investigation and evidence, right? So the word evidence gets used a lot more nowadays. And seriously, I mean, 10 years back, I wouldn't hear that term in a corporate environment. What was the evidence? They would say insights and facts and data, right? But the
Correct.
word evidence has somehow come into the parlance of corporate jingo, right? In some ways, I mean, there is this hint of investigative storytelling, if I'm getting this right.
Yes, it is. And I think as people, I think all of us love to solve a puzzle, right? So we love to kind of move forward to the next page, the page turner, classic page turner. So if we can do that, even in the corporate world, I think it makes it very, very interesting. I'll give you examples. So what makes an investigative story interesting? Let me start with fiction. The first fiction story I wrote, which is a crime novel called A Marketplace for Murder, right? It was actually based on financial crime. So I could have written it in non-fiction format, but I chose to write it as a whodunit because it would make it simpler and more exciting for the people reading it. So when I was writing this, so there was a crime at the heart of it, right? And I knew it. So there are two ways to then say it to the reader. So you will see in any crime fiction, this is what happens, right? Either the reader knows more than the person who is talking about in the story, so the main protagonist, if you can say, which makes it interesting, right? So Agatha Christie, or for example, Alfred Hitchcock, when they would say that the old lady is scared, they would bring her on the screen and she would scream, and somebody would be behind her. So the reader would know, but the lady would not know why she'd be scared. And the other thing is the person who's narrating, the narrator knows more than the reader, which is what is an unreliable narrator, right? And many people have tried it. It's been seen, and Agatha Christie tried it in Murder of Roger Ackroyd. We saw Gone Girl and multiple such, subgenres which have come up then. So this is what works in, crime fiction, that you are, you're building it like a puzzle. So you're giving parts of it, but you're not giving the entire picture, upfront, right? Now, if you come to investigative stories in when we are writing investigative stories for business from a journalism or data journalism point of view, a similar thing happens. So we have to look at information and facts being given from multiple sources, right? So somebody might say, okay, this company is doing very well. They've launched product X, and you know, they are going to grow at X percent, or this valuation is Y today. Then, you know, corroborate that with multiple other, as you said, evidence, right? Facts and information. So in classic consulting language, we call this triangulation. And only after that, you know, you present or write something. Often when you write something, it's not that deterministic that this is what will happen. It's either based on facts, this is what it looks like, or it is these could be the two scenarios. So scenarios, again, are a great way to place investigative storytelling, right? Now, when you come back to business, so these are the two examples I wanted to give from fiction and nonfiction. When you come back to business, where is it helpful and, you know, how can companies use it? So oftentimes, and I think Uday had also mentioned this earlier, a good story moves forward because of conflict, right? Conflict is what moves a good story forward. If I say Jack and Jill went up the hill and stayed on top of the hill and had a picnic there, nobody would read that story. It's not even news. It's not even an update, right? So you needed Jack to fall. So a story needs conflict to move forward. And, you know, in business, oftentimes, especially when you come to certain PR-driven, you know, news, the story the businesses tell sounds too good to be true, right? We have done X also, Y also, everything is great, right? And it sounds really too good to be true. So when it comes to investigative storytelling use in business, I'll give you a couple of examples. So this was done by, you know, done actually by P&G, where they were talking about, you know, profits and revenues of a particular business division, diapers. And they were trying to come up with a five-year strategy for diapers business. So the person who did this, Paul Smith, instead of coming with multiple analysis and 100, you know, slides which talked about different cuts of the data, he actually came up with this one graph which had revenues and profits across last 20 years. And there was one particular year in which the correlation between profits and revenues dropped. Till then, it was perfectly correlated. And all he did was, this was the starting point of the meeting. He said, what do you think happened that year? So it starts with a question. You show the evidence and you open it up for interpretations and questions and discussion. What happens then is the decisions which get taken after that are far more collaborative, and people feel that they have participated in that decision. So with data, we can actually do this. We can present options, we can give scenarios, interactive dashboards help us, you know, play around with the data ourselves. And after that, if we ask questions and brainstorm, we are in a far more, you know, better position to kind of almost ask these questions. Why did something happen and how did it happen? Than say, this is what will happen. So it moves away the deterministic part of it and makes it more collaborative and makes it more, you know, situational as well as more, you know, hypothesis driven. So that's where I would really say investigative storytelling can be used. It can be used in strategy. It can be used in sales. It can be used in places where you don't have 100% information and you still have to take a decision and you still have to get people to kind of collaborate and agree and move forward. That's where it works best. I'll stop here. I know I spoke a lot. I'll stop here, you know, for other ideas and thoughts.
So, Uday, before you come in, just an invitation to the listeners, right? The places must have opened up now. So if you want to join the conversation, please do jump in.
Fascinating. I just love this topic. I mean, I think the only reason all of us fall in love with storytelling is because we would have read Investigative or a Hercule Poirot or written by Agatha Christie. And that's the reason when I fell into love. But you know, Deblina, you make some awesome points. I'll probably take a minute or so. I'll give you a example of exact one of my favorite investigative stories that I worked on and put it up in the blog. But before that, Christopher Nolan once talked about narrative, and he defined narrative like this. He said the only useful definition of a narrative is that it is a controlled release of information. How you release the information is up to you. Okay, so the only useful definition of a narrative is that it is a controlled release of information. That is exactly what storytelling is all about. You know, in most stories, you know that the bad guy will eventually come out, but it's how the storyteller chooses to release the information. And that makes this whole thing very gripping, and it's very, very well used, especially in this entire whodunits and classic whodunits, right? And most of them really happened. If you look at the history of whodunits, all of it happened during the World War II. Edgar Allan Poe and Agatha Christie, all of these people. But you take this entire thing about investigative business journalism. One of my classic examples that I'm absolutely in awe with is this entire thing about how So, for example, October 2006, Jeffrey's killing was one of the guys who was suddenly who was sentenced by the Texas court for about 24 years. Now, he wasn't a murderer, he wasn't a rapist, he wasn't a burglar. He was the CEO of a Fortune 500 company. It was the most admired company called Enron. Now, at that point of time, now what happened? 6 years before, there was an investigative journalist, a string reporter for the Wall Street Journal called Jonathan Wheel. He got a call from one of the Wall Street guys. He just got one call. That guy said, why don't you look at Enron and see what they're doing really? And this got Jonathan to dig in. And suddenly Jonathan realized that, look, there is so much of information available on Enron. The balance sheets were so detailed. In fact, it was almost like there was a surfeit of information. There was nothing which was not disclosed. It took him about 6 months to crack it. You know, Enron used to do something called mark to market kind of a thing. Very simply explained, let us say Enron sold to the state of California $100 billion of electricity, and they would give them 10 years later. It simply meant that no money would come to Enron and only a contract would be signed. But what Enron did, they took it into their balance sheets as an asset. Second thing which Enron did is that, for example, you didn't even know whether it was going to be profit or loss. But Enron speculated that the prices of electricity would fall, and they actually booked profit in their accounts. Now, this entire thing was understood by Jonathan only after he spent 6 months talking to the Harvard business professors, accounts and all. And finally, on the Wall Street Journal, when he broke the story, $747 million of profit was not there in the bank. There was no cash flow Enron had. And that triggered Enron's crash. But Anurag and Debina, the thing about Enron's story is what is fascinating is that Enron never denied anything. Enron, in fact, flew down their entire CFOs to the next day to Wall Street Journal office and said, look, we've disclosed everything. But the investigation just still proceeded, right? It was all about interpretation. In fact, when the final report of Enron's atrocities were coming in, you know how big the report was? It was 1,20,000 pages. And they did a summary of a summary of a summary of a summary of a summary, which eventually became 250 pages of mind-numbingly complex thing which the jury finally had to understand and convict. Enron is a classic case of puzzle versus mystery. And this is not my thing. This is what I read from Malcolm Gladwell's investigation. He says that, look, there are two ways in which you approach a whodunit, a puzzle or a mystery. And he said that if people, the investigative journalists in the case of Enron, if they looked at it as a puzzle, which means that they were searching for a missing piece, they would have never solved it. But they approached it like a mystery, which means they had to think out of the box. And that is great storytelling, right? That's why it is sensational. And that is why storytelling gets to the next level. And that's one example. And yeah, so that's one example I thought I had to share in the context of this entire investigative storytelling.
Fascinating, Uday. You know, Devlina, when you were earlier kind of referring to this whole idea of collaborative, you know, decision making in organizations, right? I could so relate to it, right? That when people create some amount of uncertainty, right, and present data and evidence and whatever else and allow for multiple levels of interpretations, right? That's when you can expect some level of collaboration, right? Otherwise, it's just people trying to refute or buy into your confidence, which is what it is most of the time, rather than certainty in such kind of decision making. That makes sense?
Yeah, it is. You know, typically the discussions then become more about this number is not correct versus what direction can we take from this? Because especially in strategy and in, you know, larger decisions around sales about the company, you'll never have perfect information. We always have to deal with hypothesis and incomplete information. I'll give you know, a couple of other examples very quickly. So, you know, many of us probably would have seen Scam 92, right? Again, a classic example of investigative journalism and what happened after that. But again, you know, there are many shades to every story like that. You know, Uday mentioned one example. We have seen many such other examples. Even after the story is broken and everything is proven, it's still not the entire truth. So I think that ambiguity is what makes it even more interesting. And that's what, you know, even as people like us who write such stories and, you know, work in such spaces, we have to be very careful not to sound judgmental and not to be judgmental of what happened. So I'll give you one more example. This is something I'm doing right now. So all of us have, you know, seen what has happened in education over the last year after closures, etc. Now there's a very interesting trend which I'm tracking and I'm writing about, which is, you know, 70% of schools were government schools earlier, 30% were private schools, out of which 20% were the low-income private schools. After the lockdown and after the continuous school closures of last 15 months, what is happening to schools today, right, is a very interesting question, and data is still not keeping up with it because, you know, data from DICE is more than a year old. There are schools which are just not going to be able to open up anymore. And where are those students going to go? So, you know, the data I'm trying to cover, therefore, is looking at government school admissions, looking at, you know, school closures, looking at M&A between schools, larger private schools. And there are multiple ways to, you know, kind of piece together this information and then really ask the larger question, you know, what will happen next year? Where will these kids, you know, these 20% of kids, 20% of 260 million school-going kids is a very large number. Even if 1% of that is a question mark, imagine the numbers, right? So where will those kids go? So I think there are fascinating questions which can be asked, and not every question can be answered. But I think being comfortable with that ambiguity, and then, you know, having certain amount of collaborative decisions being taken from that ambiguity is, I think, where the beauty of investigative storytelling lies in business.
In fact, Deblina, another way in which I have used it in one corporate workshop is to build in this entire element of puzzle / mystery into a simulation game where, yeah, you know, typically...
Games, I think strategy teams, you know, use simulation games quite well.
Yeah.
But there, you know, the uncertainty part can play in. The investigative part sometimes gets missed. For example, you know, when we worked in Fidelity, you know, the entire strategy team's decision making was based on a, you know, it was like a game theory, right? So if you had X amount of money and you had finite choices of ABC, where would you put maximum money? So it's more, I think, Anurag, probably we have discussed this in one more Mensa, I think, is, you know, game theory applications in competitive intelligence and strategy. So that goes into a slightly different discipline. And again, we can discuss that. I think the investigative part sometimes, you know, doesn't come out so much because, again, often I think the issue is people are not very comfortable with the ambiguity, which needs to be accepted before you, you know, go on a journey like this.
Yeah, I mean, the only thing is that, you know, it's also very difficult to make a corporate buy into this whole thing of investing so much of time in investigating it and making it. But what we try and do, what we try and did was to kind of mix it up with case studies and reflections within the simulation so that it was not an obvious thing that you have to just pick up what is there on the choices, but also maybe come with something out of the box. And that is where I think the whole element of story and the investigative data journalism works. In some of the courses that I do in data storytelling as well, so I keep telling this thing with everyone. So just because there is a lot of transparency, just because there is a lot of data available, it never really means that people understand you. In fact, I'm out of Samsung. Samsung versus Apple, a classic story, right? We've got a lot of features in Samsung. There's so much of information in Samsung. And Apple goes with that one or two pointed thing and tells a very good story about it. It's a classic case of simplicity. Someone really able to understand what is there and this is what I can get. And to a large extent, data storytelling, investigative storytelling on business within organizations is more about someone being understood and simplifying enough to keep it relatable to people. I think that's a huge thing of a storyteller.
And I also feel, you know, Deblina, that, you know, when you're talking about ambiguity and uncertainty, so what I take away is that it's not that ambiguity and uncertainty has to be inherently present in an environment, right? This is a storyteller's design, that he's trying to introduce ambiguity to create some kind of a new decision format, which is a little different from how game theory applications happen, right? Where there is uncertainty in the environment, right?
Exactly. Which is, I'm saying, it's two very different things. You know, game theory applications in strategy and in competitive intelligence are by nature, you know, designed in a different way and they can work in very different ways. This, you know, actually using a more uncertain investigative format can be leveraged very powerfully. But it has a very different design, a very different thinking and very different use case where it can be applied.
when the environment itself is ambiguous, when current situations where you don't know what is the kind of growth that is going to come, how are the consumer segments shifting? So these are, in fact, the school example that you gave, that requires a lot of data mining, and that requires a lot of spotting insights from masses of data and then simplifying it. I think those are the use cases where there's a whole lot of inherent ambiguity in the system.
Yeah, and even when, you know, sometimes I see Jay, you know, mentioning market share reports by third party. Yeah, I think all those have to be done. But, you know, whenever we are talking about some of these decisions, the data itself might have a lag, right? In this case, it's more than a year lag. So it won't capture the actual shift of the pandemic. Similarly, in health data, right? A lot of the health data currently, what we are seeing today is still pre-pandemic. So we don't know exactly what will happen next year. So therefore, you have to build scenarios, which, you know, is done in strategy, but you also might have to therefore show some examples and some, you know, kind of patterns where people can make inferences instead of saying this is what will happen for sure.
You know, Anurag, in one of the in the same article that Malcolm Gladwell writes about investigative storytelling, and he says that look, Watergate scandal, Bernstein and Woodward, they are the two journalists who are credited to do that, and they got a Pulitzer Prize for it. Mm-hmm. He says that look, the way these guys went about solving the Watergate scandal was they filled in pieces of information which they knew were available around their place. I mean, someone who spoke, someone would have done that, someone would have given a bribe, etc. So information was around there and they just had to kind of pull it off. Now that's a puzzle. They would have, he goes on to say that look, these guys would probably never have been the ones who would have cracked the Enron, simply because, like Deblina says, Enron's case was the classic ambiguity case. Everyone thought they were doing the right thing. And it was more like, look, we gave you all the information. In case you need any explanation, you can connect with us and ask us more about it. So it was more like that. So, you know, that's exactly
sometimes the other question, which is also tricky, is who's going to call it when you see things happening, right? For example, we saw this.